Good morning. Welcome to Living Hope Bible Church. I see most of you recovered from your turkey hangover you had. Oh, we got all kinds of people here today. There's the Davises over there. Albert's here on the upper deck over there, kind of filled that end up over there. Good to see everybody. Congratulations, Lindsay and husband. Ryan, sorry. I got cued over here. So good to see you guys this morning. And anyway, you've all been eating the same thing since Thursday. You still got the refrigerator about cleaned out now, so you can start on something new. But good to have you with us this morning. Would you stand? We're going to sing some hymn there. And I think Larry and Brenda are ready. Take it away, Larry. Lord, Heavenly Father, we just thank you for this day you provided. As we just got done celebrating Thanksgiving, Lord, we are still truly thankful for all the blessings you bestow upon us, Lord. And we just thank you so much for the opportunity to gather in your house this morning, Lord, to worship you. We just thank you so much for all the people that are gathered here this morning. Bless each and every one. Lord, just fill this place with your Holy Spirit this morning, Lord, that we can feel you moving among us. Lord, that we be changed because we've been in your presence. Lord, just thank you so much for all that you do. And Lord, especially thank you for Jesus, who you sent to hang on that cross, to die a violent death, to cover our sins, Lord, that we may spend eternity in heaven with you, Lord. Just bless this time together to your holy name. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated.
Well, today is the start of Advent. And so we're going to light our first Advent candle. And today we look ahead with anticipation and hope for the coming Jesus. What do you think the word anticipation means? The definition of anticipation is looking forward to something. What are you looking forward to at this time of year? We look forward to Christmas because we remember that Jesus was born into our world to bring us hope, life, and love. We remember when Jesus talked about a fig tree and how when we see leaves start to grow on it, we can also anticipate summer coming. There are a lot of things that point to summer. The first robin, leaves growing on a tree, or the first flower in bloom. There's lots of things that show us that Jesus is coming again when we look to those with hope. Jesus coming back isn't scary for us. It fills us with hope because we know that he's going to make all the bad in the world right. So we light the first candle of Advent, the candle of hope. As we do, we remember all the ways that Jesus will make the world right. Our hope comes from Him. The light from the candle reminds us that Jesus came into the world to bring us hope, love, and life. Let's pray. Dear Lord, there's a lot of places in our world that are sad and that are broken. Lord, we hope for a lot of things, for wars to end, for families to stop fighting, and so much more. Today we remember that you are coming back and you're going to make things right. We anticipate the hope of your return, and we look forward to the celebration of your birth when you brought the world hope, love, and life. Amen. At this time, I want you to look at the bulletins and see the names that are listed there. We do welcome the Davises back. Wendy, you want to wave at everybody? What's the question we always ask, Wendy? Are you happy? I'm happy. Are you happy, Wendy? Well, I'm glad to see you. You see the names listed. I want to make sure that we pray also for Rowan Bowes, Quincy's daughter. On the 22nd, she gets her adenoids out and tonsils out, so we need to make sure and pray for her. She's going to be put under. And then we were asked to pray for Dr. Finneran, who has served in Davis County and Van Buren, John Finneran, to make sure and pray for him. Any other prayer concerns? Awesome. So, Michelle's dad went in for lung surgery, and he was returned home within 24 hours. So, and he was dancing it up too. Any other prayer concerns? So Paul Weiland's Aunt Mona is having tests done, is that? Okay. She had a stroke. Any other prayer concerns? Okay. Let's go before the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, coming off Thanksgiving, Lord, we are especially mindful of you and you providing the provisions that we need each and every day. Lord, whether it's food or, Lord, if it is a roof over our head or friends and family, Lord, you answer our prayers, and we are just humbly grateful for you at work in our lives and for answering our prayers. So, Lord, we just thank you and we praise you. We thank you for answered prayers day in and day out, Lord. Sometimes we forget to give you praise for those. And, Lord, we have all these names on our list, those that were spoken today and those that are listed. Lord, there are people that we know, people that we love, and then there are total strangers, Lord, that maybe we've just heard about. And Lord, we give each situation to you, and we humbly ask that you hear our cries. Lord, we know that you're good and that you're faithful. And so, Lord, I pray that you just give them exactly what they need and the amount that they need it. Lord, today I just pause also to pray for the other churches in our area, not just Eldon, but all the churches in this area. Lord, I just pray that they may be successful. Lord, that they may bring your word to a broken people. And Lord, they may be a light to the community. And so, Lord, just bless them in every way, shape, and form. And Lord, I just pray that you call them to be faithful. And so, Lord, we have all these things that we humbly give to you today. In Jesus' name, amen. So at this time, we're going to receive the tithes and offerings. It's a time that you can take them back. There's a box in the back, and on top of the box, there is a basket. And the basket is for something we call our harvest offering. And all of the proceeds from that go into our account to take care of the physical plant or the building and the outdoor part of our church as well. And so it includes things like snow removal. Isn't that what you want to talk about today? Snow removal? No, and lawn care, as well as heating and air as well. And so that's what that's for. We do that just to bolster that. And then the box is the normal offering. And so at that time, you can take that back there. And Larry and Brenda have a special for you today.
Well, along that same note of being thankful, the first verse of this song that I want to sing this morning is saying to be thankful for the rain and the snow. And sometimes that's kind of hard for us to be thankful for when it comes to snow. But the snow does give us moisture in the ground, and we do need to be thankful for all the things that the Lord does for us. This morning, I'd like to share a song with you that talks about being thankful. And it gives many of the things that I'm thankful for. And I think you probably are too, if you think about it. The song's just entitled, Thank You, Lord. For making the sun to shine, putting the stars in the sky, for the flowers that bloom, the ocean so blue, thank you, Lord. For every sparrow that sings and makes sweet melody, for the rivers that flow, the rain and the snow, thank you, Lord. I just want to thank you, Lord. I just want to thank you, Lord, for everything you've done for me. Thank you, Lord. I just want to thank you, Lord. I just want to thank you, Lord, for making me whole, saving my soul. Thank you, Lord, for my whole family, for the joy my children bring, for shoes on our feet, plenty to eat. Thank you, Lord, for the church where I worship and pray, for the freedoms I have today, for your spirit I feel and presence so real. Thank you, Lord. I just want to thank you, Lord. I just want to thank you, Lord, for everything you've done for me. Thank you, Lord. I just want to thank you, Lord. I just want to thank you, Lord, for making me whole, saving my soul. Thank you, Lord. This last verse is really kind of my verse. I remember times when I couldn't stand and when I needed a friend, and this verse talks about that. He's our friend and he's our Savior. For making a friend so dear, giving my sad heart cheer, for holding my hand when I could not stand. Thank you, Lord, for giving your life for me on the cross at Calvary. For taking my place, for mercy and grace. Thank you, Lord. I just want to thank you, Lord. I just want to thank you, Lord, for I just want to thank you, Lord. I just want to thank you, Lord, for making me whole, saving my soul. Thank you, Lord, for making me whole, saving my soul. Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Larry and Brenda. That was great, great reminder for all of us. At this time, I want to invite the children to meet in the back. Michelle will be taking the preschool through third graders, and then LaVon will be taking the fourth through the seventh. Let me say a blessing over them. Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you for bringing each one of these kiddos into this place. And Lord, I ask that you bless their time here. Lord, keep them safe. And Lord, let them feel your love, grace, and mercy shown through LaVon and Michelle. Lord, I ask that you bless them as well. Thank you for their faithfulness and their diligence. And so, Lord, I just pray for all of them as they depart from here, and Lord, let them learn all about you. In Jesus' name, amen. As they are leaving, I want to invite Leanne to come up. She's going to read Isaiah 9, 1 through 7.
Isaiah 9, 1 through 7 is entitled, "To Us a Child is Born." Nevertheless, there will be no more gloom. For those who were in distress in the past, he humbled the land of Zebulun and the land of Naphtali. But in the future, he will honor Galilee of the Gentiles by the way of the sea along the Jordan. The people walking in darkness have seen a great light on those living in the land of the shadow of death. A light has dawned. You have enlarged the nation and increased their joy. They rejoice before you as people rejoice at the harvest, as men rejoice when dividing the plunder. For as in the day of Midian's defeat, you have shattered the yoke that burdens them, the bar across their shoulders, the rod of their oppressor. Every warrior's boot used in battle and every garment rolled in blood will be destined for burning, will be the fuel for the fire. For unto us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government will be on his shoulders, and he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Of the increase of his government and peace there will be no end. He will reign on David's throne and over his kingdom, establishing and upholding it with justice and righteousness from that time on and forever. The zeal of the Lord Almighty will accomplish this.
Will you join me as we ask a blessing on Pastor Mark this morning? Lord Heavenly Father, we just ask for a special infilling of your Holy Spirit for Pastor Mark this morning. Just fill him to overflowing, Lord, as he brings your message, Lord. Make it be informative and something that we can carry with us always, Lord. Just bless us now as we hear your word. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Well, it's good to see you all here today. I know this time of year with Thanksgiving and everything, it can be a really busy time. And so we had a great Thanksgiving at our house and had lots of family back, some from Kentucky and some from Illinois and Northern Iowa, and so it's been a great time for us as well. We just finished up the Essential 100 Stories, 100 Sundays. You start adding that up, and it's over 2 years. And so pretty incredible. We got through the book of Revelation, and last week we learned about heaven and what the new Jerusalem's going to look like. And so it was interesting when I saw what Sunday it was going to fall on. I'm like, hey, I think that's the start of Advent, which is our season on looking towards Christmas. And then I had to check about 100 times. I'm like, surely this can't be Advent, but it is. And so here we are in Advent, that preparation time. So looking forward to Christmas. And so this is when we start the Christmas messages. And isn't it interesting that today's message come out of Isaiah for Christmas, right? And a time when Isaiah wrote that, Jesus wasn't even born yet. And so here we are. So our key question today is based on the sermon series. Who needs Christmas? Who needs Christmas? I think you already know the answer to that. We all need it. But today I want to focus on this idea. When you read Scripture, you understand how much God cares for this group of people. The downtrodden, the weary, the tired, the broken, the grieving, the sick, the worn. The list could go on and on and on. You think about the people that Jesus sought after was the ones that society was saying they have no value. And you look at that list, and I could identify myself on that list at some point in time in my life, or at what point in the week that we're talking, right? Like, yeah, I'm tired, I'm worn out, I'm sick. So the key verse is from Isaiah 9. I'm not going to read it. Leanne just read it. But ultimately, I'm going to be focusing on this idea that Jesus is the wonderful counselor. You know, one of my favorite things to do, I'm kind of sentimental. It's interesting, when my family gets together, I'm the one that's sentimental. I blame it on my grandfather. So my grandfather owned a junkyard out in western Iowa. If you take 34 to the other side of the state over near Lenox, my grandpa ran a junkyard in the same spot for 50 years. And he held on to absolutely everything. He lived through the Depression, and everything was sentimental to him, and he held on to everything. So I blame my sentimentality on my grandfather. And I like this time of year when you get all of the boxes down and you get everything out and you pull out the ornaments that say either like Grant and Ben's first Christmas, and you see their baby picture on it. Or Tony Garrett and I worked for a company called Laser Machining in Somerset, Wisconsin. And our owner invented the laser engraver, the engravers that are popular today. He is the one who kind of developed that. And so every Christmas, they would make and design an ornament. And they would do this big release on what this ornament was and what it looked like. And it was always wood and laser engraved and laser cut, and then we would assemble them, and it was this big ordeal, and it was a lot of fun. And so I have 9 years worth of those ornaments, and I'm sure Tony and Carrie have those same ornaments as well. And so that was something. I look at those and I remember that time, and that is the purpose, right, of the things that we hold on to, that we remember those events in our life. And it's important to remember them because it gives you a foundation to build upon. Well, in the Old Testament, that was one of the things that God kept telling his people Israel to remember, remember, remember. So if you think about one thing today, remember the word remember. That is the key theme today, remember. And so if you stop and think about Israel, Stop and think about the things that they witnessed, right? At one point in time, they found themselves as slaves in Egypt, and they were working day and night and day and night, and they kept crying out to God, and finally God delivered to them a great leader in Moses. And so here Moses comes in, and he leads them, and he goes to the Pharaoh, and he says, "Let my people go," right? And the Pharaoh says no. And so God brings a plague. And it was a massive plague, right? All over Egypt. And one after another, we know that he was defeating each of Egypt's gods. But in reality, he was also demonstrating who he was and the power he has to his people, the Israelites. And so they saw each one of those. And finally, Pharaoh said, "Okay, get out of Egypt." And so here they are. They're going, and Pharaoh starts chasing them. You remember this story. And then the Red Sea opens up, and they go across. They turn around, and the Red Sea closes in on them. Keep in mind, they saw plague after plague after plague. They saw the Red Sea part. That's enough for me to go, from now on, I'm going to do whatever God says, right? That's a lot of evidence. So then he leads them through the wilderness. By day, God's a cloud. By night, it's a pillar of fire, and they're to follow God. Pretty incredible still. And so all of these miracles, one after another, you would think they would follow God without question. And a matter of fact, at one point, Moses sends people into the promised land to say, "Hey, can we go take the promised land?" And the spies come back and they say, half of them say, "Oh, they're pretty big. I don't think we could take them." The other half's like, "Let's go get it," right? That's what they were looking at. And ultimately, Moses says, "You know what? Let's wait. Let's not go conquer the promised land." And God punishes Moses. Moses never, ever got to see the promised land. Instead, he took him to a mountain and says, "Look forward. That's the promised land. That's the land that your people are going to go and conquer." And so he raises up Joshua. Joshua leads them into the promised land. And at one point, they cross the Jordan in the same way that they cross the Red Sea. It parts, right? And God tells them to remember this point. And so in Joshua 4, 6 through 7, he says, "Let this be a sign among you, so when your children ask later," let me back up a minute. He had 12 people, each from one of the different tribes, go into the center of the Jordan River, take out a big boulder, carry it out, and they assembled this pile of rocks, right? And it was at this point that he was saying, "Let this be a sign among you, that when your children ask later, saying, 'What are these stones? What do they mean to you?' then you shall say to them, 'Because the waters of the Jordan were cut off before the Ark of the Covenant of the Lord, when it crossed the Jordan, the waters of the Jordan were cut off, so that these stones shall become a memorial to the sons of Israel forever.'" Whenever they saw this pile of rocks, they'd say, "Hey, what is this pile of rocks here for?" That was the day God parted the waters and we were able to cross the Jordan, and we remember that to this day. We all have those piles of rocks in our life that we remember, right? At the time of graduation, Roy gives each graduate a stake. And the idea behind that stake is they're to drive it into a place that they remember that that is home. That is a place that they can return to. It's to help them remember. And so it is, the Israelites were to build this pile of rocks. By the way, that's called an Ebenezer, a time of remembrance, something to see and remember what God had done. We all have those in our lives. We have these Ebenezers in our life, these stakes in our life where we say, "God met us right there. In our most desperate time of need, God met us there." I can take you to several places in my life where I remember God touching me. And so it is with Israel. He was telling them to not forget what he had done. It becomes a foundation. And then in the book of Judges, so you think the Israelites saw all of these things. And now my pages are stuck together. There we go. My bookmark failed me. There we go. So Israel, you would have thought they'd seen the 10 plagues, crossed a couple of rivers on dry ground. They had seen the pillar of fire. They had seen the cloud. They had seen God at work, God at work, God at work. They had built the monuments. They should never, ever forget, right? And then comes Judges 2, 6 through 10. Joshua, their leader, when Joshua had dismissed the people, the sons of Israel went each to his inheritance to possess the land, the promised land. The people served the Lord all the days of Joshua and all the days of the elders who survived Joshua, who had seen all the great work of the Lord, which he had done for Israel. Then Joshua, the son of Nun, the servant of the Lord, died at the age of 110. You know my old joke? What person in the Bible didn't have any parents? Joshua, because he was the son of Nun. Okay. You can use that this week, okay? You're like, no, I've already forgotten it. Some things you remember, some things you forget. And so here he was. He died at the age of 110. They buried him in the territory of his inheritance. And then it says one of the most heartbreaking verses of the Bible. Verse 10. All that generation also were gathered to their fathers, and there arose another generation after them who did not know the Lord, nor yet the work which he had done for Israel. You see, they didn't pass on their faith. I don't know where you're at, but I'll hear parents tell me, well, I want to give my kids a choice. I say, you know, I don't have a problem giving my kids some choices about where to eat, where to shop, what favorite football team you have. That was a mistake. But the one thing that I'm going to pass down to them is my faith. Because it radically changed my life. Why wouldn't I want it for them? God has been so incredibly good to me. Why wouldn't I want them to experience and live life that way? And they didn't. They saw miracle after miracle after miracle. And you say, one time I told someone, well, I wish God would do that for me in my life. Show me all those miracles. And they looked at me and said, Mark, you need to look harder. There's been miracles in your life. If you stop and process and really think about it, where God has interacted with you and blessed you in a tremendous way, it doesn't mean that it's easy or perfect. But when you come out of it, you can go, whoa, God was good to me. And it's important for us not to be that generation that forgets what God has done for us in the past. You see, this time was a dark time. And when Isaiah came about, it was still a dark time. And it said, the people who walk in darkness will see a great light. Those who live in a dark land, the light will shine on them. Do you understand how much hope is possessed in light? Imagine if you live in total darkness all the time. Psychologically, you become depressed. And it affects you. And so imagine living in this darkness, but you know a great light is coming. In John 1:1, this may be a passage you're familiar with. In the beginning was the Word. By the way, the Word is Jesus. And the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God, and all things came into being through Him, and apart from Him, nothing came into being and has come into being. In Him was life, and the life was the light of men. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness did not comprehend it. You see, darkness resists light. All darkness is an absence of light. And so when you have a dark world and a light shines, it totally changes everything around it. And so imagine a dark, dark world, evil rulers, and a promise of light. That's an incredible promise. And so he goes on, Isaiah. Remember, this is generations before Jesus was ever born. Isaiah's writing this. Remember, I always call Isaiah the fifth gospel. You have Matthew, Mark, Luke, John. Those are all testifying about Jesus. And then you have the fifth gospel, which is Isaiah, who testified about Jesus before he was ever born. I love that. And so here it is. For a child will be born to us. A son will be given to us. And the government will rest on his shoulders. And his name will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Eternal Father, Prince of Peace. A son will be given to us by God the Father. And we'll call him Wonderful Counselor. I want to pause for a moment and just dwell on the fact that we call him Wonderful Counselor. Let's start with the word wonderful. Wonderful. In this instance, it really is talking about something mysterious and something secret. It's really not a descriptive word. It's not an adjective. But wonderful is a way to describe his counseling. You think about Jesus come in, and nobody was really anticipating it until the star come, and people were wondering what was so great that was happening in Bethlehem that day. And so he came unannounced, really. And then the counselor. You notice Jesus never went to anyone and asked their opinion because he had the truth. He didn't need counseling. He gave counseling. He was the most wonderful counselor. You think about all the people Jesus ministered to, and he met them in their deepest need. The woman at the well, he did ask questions, but he didn't condemn her. Instead, he challenged her to a better life. You remember the adulteress who was thrown down before him, and he challenged everybody there and challenged her to go and sin no more. Nicodemus, who appeared to have it all together, a religious elite, and he challenged him to a better life as well, and to follow him. Every one of his disciples, he met right where they were. He took Peter, who kept failing him, and he kept building him up to a greater ministry, to a greater purpose on this life, to the point that Peter built the church. He even met Paul on the road to Damascus, the man who was killing Christians. He reached out and he touched him and delivered him and redeemed him. And Paul went on to write the rest of the New Testament. The Bible tells us that God cares about the least and the lost. He cares about that one lost sheep that is gone. He cares about the lost coin that went missing. And he cares about the prodigal son who thought he knew better than God and ran away. Where are you today? Are you tired? Are you weary? Are you worn? Are you grieving? Christmas serves that time where we do remember. You can't help but remember previous Christmases. I still think when I see a Christmas tree, I remember the time, the Christmas tree, we were putting it up and it fell on my dad. And all of us kids were laughing so hard, and he was so mad that we weren't getting it off, but we were laughing so hard. And then once we got it off, we laughed all the more. You remember those things, but when you remember, we also remember the tough times. And we remember the fact that our loved ones aren't with us. We remember that life isn't perfect, and our loved ones aren't perfect. But God meets us in our bitterness. He meets us in our loneliness. He meets us in our losses, and he meets us with our stresses. Maybe it's our finances and we're worried about making Christmas work. God will meet us where we're at. Do you remember the story of Elijah? And I told this story, it kind of came into my head. Elijah had just had a duel with the gods. He had built the fire, or he had assembled wood, and the prophets of Baal assembled their wood. And he gave 24 hours or something like that and let the prophets try to have Baal burn up their offering. And time came and went and they didn't do it. It didn't happen. And then Elijah, in his bravado, doused his with water, just poured it with lots and lots of water, even built a moat around it and poured water in it. And he called down on God to burn up the offering, and God did, and even lapped up the last drink of water, and it was all gone. God delivered Elijah the greatest. That was, what a great defeat, right? And yet, he forgot what God had just done, literally. And he fled because he was worried they were going to kill him. And he went and he hid in a cave, and God kept giving him food and sustenance and helped him live. And then finally he shows up to Elijah in a still, small voice. That's how God works, isn't it? He shows up in the subtle ways. And he simply provides for us. And he gives us strength when we don't know where it could possibly come from. And then I think about how Jesus entered the world as a little baby in a manger. And he radically changed the world. This Christmas, I want you to always be looking to the manger, looking to Christ. And remember that in your deepest, darkest times, you'll find him reaching for you. And you can draw on his strength and his wisdom and his might. We're going to take communion today. Oh, I didn't even give you your how now shall we live. I was honed in. Let me leave you with this. How now shall I live? The first thing I want you to remember, I want you to look back over your past and maybe literally do this. Go home. Don't eat dinner today. No, eat dinner. go home and make a list. Make a timeline. Have you ever done this? Make a timeline of the significant events in your life. And just say, Lord, where were you in those events? Good, the bad, the ugly. And make note on where God was at work in your life during those events. You'll be amazed at where God saw you through. And you see, that becomes the foundation for your life. Because understanding that God has worked in your past will give you that foundation to move forward. So that when the next thing happens, you say, well, God got me through that. I can have the confidence that God is going to get me through the next. That's why we choose to remember. Now, some things you don't want to dwell on, remember them. But if they're that painful, remember them, but don't dwell on them. Just remember that God got you through. You can use it to understand your current situation, that it's going to be temporary, and that God will get you through. And then ultimately, you can look to the future with hope. Hope is a powerful thing, isn't it? Hope is what is missing in some people's lives. And yet, hope is what can propel us into the future. So communion is a time that Jesus specifically told us, this do in remembrance of me. We remember what Jesus did for us. And so Jesus had gathered all his disciples together. They were celebrating the Passover meal. That time when Jesus led them out of Egypt, they celebrated, and by the way, they still celebrate today, the Passover meal. And they were celebrating, and Jesus took the common elements on every Passover meal. There were certain prescribed things on the table, every Passover table. And this time he took the bread. It was unleavened bread. They were in a hurry when they left Egypt, so they didn't have time to let it rise. So it was unleavened bread, and he broke it. And he said, this is my body broken for you. And then he took the cup that was on every table, and he asked a blessing on it, and he said, this is the blood of the new covenant. The old covenant was the Mosaic covenant. It was the Ten Commandments. It was living a life of structured rules, right? And Jesus came to fulfill that and then offer a new form of redemption found in him and his life, death, and resurrection. And so he said, this is the blood of the new covenant. And then he said, this do in remembrance of me. We don't do it just to remember the historical Jesus. We remember that he came, lived a perfect life, died on the cross for our sins, and rose again, triumphing over our sins and the sins of the world and of Satan himself. And so when we go to communion today, we remember what Jesus did for us, that he forgave our sins, that he bestows the grace and mercy that each one of us so desire. So today, just simply go before the Lord and say, Lord, forgive me of all the sins that I've committed before you. And this I know, he'll offer you the grace and the mercy and the forgiveness. Maybe not that we deserve, but what Jesus did for us. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, Lord, we cling to you. We know you're faithful, and we know you're good. Lord, I pray that you forgive us, each one of us, for our sins, for all those ways that we fall short of your glory and of you. And so, Lord, I pray that you restore and redeem each one of us, and to help us become the person that you designed and created us to be. In Jesus' name, amen. Our table is open to anyone who's actively seeking Jesus. It doesn't mean that you have life figured out or that you know everything there is to know about Christianity. It merely means that you're seeking him. And so I want to invite you. You can take the cup and the bread are in the same package. The bread's on the bottom, the drink's on top. And you can either bring it to the altar and kneel before God there. I'll be in the front row. You can come and let me pray with you, or if you want to chat. Or you can just take it back to your seat. But whenever you're ready, you can come and partake.
I've been hard on myself lately. Every morning I feel the weight. When it's hard to just get out of bed, tell my heart, 'cause sometimes I forget that your mercies are new today. Your mercies are new today. Oh, I can rest on your shoulders. There is grace to start over. Your mercies are new today. Oh, your mercies are new today. Help me rise like the morning sun. Help me see that your work's not done. Oh, Lord. When I'm less what I want to be, Lord, I need you to keep reminding me your mercies are new.
It's my prayer that God met you right where you're at. It's a special time that God set aside for us to remember what Jesus did for us. You see, God knew we were a forgetful people, and so he would send signs for us to help us remember of his covenants and to remember of his faithfulness and to remember his goodness. We don't want to fall into the same trap that the Israelites did. and start this endless cycle of sinning and crying out to God. Instead, we can do it each and every day to turn to Him and say, Lord, please be the Lord of my life. And that's what I want to encourage you to do. So this Christmas, use this time to look forward to Christmas. That's why we have Advent. In some ways, the candles are a countdown for us to remind us that Christmas is coming, so that we don't wake up on Christmas morning and say, oh, it's Christmas. I forgot to prepare for it. No, we want to be ready so that when Christmas Day comes, that we're ready to celebrate. Let's stand and sing our hymn of invitation. And during this time, if you need prayer for anything, come and let me pray with you. Father, Lord, we praise you today. Lord, we just thank you for being so good to us, and Lord, for providing us in for everything each and every day. And so, Lord, let us never forget. Let us remember you and how good you are to us. And let that be a firm foundation for us to stand on and to launch into the future, understanding we have the hope of Christ with us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Well, it's good to worship with you today, and we'll see you again next week. And we do have some announcements for you.
Okay.
Don's anxious and ready.
Yeah, I'm here. So, first of all, the children's ministries are on this week. On Wednesday, Jam and Blast eat at 6 p.m., lesson at 6:30. CIA eats at 6:30, lesson at 7. There's going to be a live nativity the 4th of December at downtown Eldon in the courtyard from 5 to 7 p.m. And if you would like to participate, talk to Carrie Garrett. Were they looking for a camel or what are they? I don't know.
Yeah, that would be fun.
I don't know.
Maybe.
I just want. Anyway, if you're interested in that, talk to Carrie.
If you want to be part of the live nativity.
Yeah.
And if you want to come for just, say, a half hour or an hour and stand, you can. And if we get enough people, maybe we'll sing carols and things like that.
Okay, very good. Also, the election of officers are coming up on the 9th of January, but the petitions or nomination forms are out. And so those are out in the foyer, I take it, and then they need to be turned in no later than the 26th of December. So, and also the Living Hope Preschool fundraising envelopes are still out there in the foyer. And pick one of them up, fill it with money, bring it back. And remember the candlelight service coming up. That's not that far away now.
Yep.
The 24th at 6 p.m., the candlelight Thanksgiving or Christmas. Eve.
I
got Thanksgiving on the brain.
The Thanksgiving now, so, Eve, we missed that service.
And I think Michelle has some important announcement here.
No, I just wanted to thank everyone for supporting the preschool for the PIE fundraiser. We made I didn't make it. I just was there for support. But 192 PIEs this year, so that was great. Kate and Arlene and Patsy Bowes were the ones that were the heads of making the PIEs. And we had some parents and others that helped. And I know Winnie came to sit while I was up in Rochester to hand out PIEs. And I had some parents that Alicia and Jennifer Hostetler and Jennifer Castle came and helped. But just thank you for all the support for the preschool, because it goes for a good cause. So, And hopefully you guys enjoyed your pies. And I can't eat them, so that's an unfortunate part of it, because I'm allergic to them.
Well, I did my part.
Yeah, you did your part. So, but just thank you for supporting, and for some of them that just gave us donations also that didn't get pies. So thank you again.
All right. Thank you. All right. Well, we'll see you next week. Remember, we're in the Advent season, so how exciting is that? We'll sing our closing hymn, Go Tell It on the Mountain.